If you thought Gentefied was amazing the first season, season two kicks it up a notch. Hello, everybody, and welcome back to another episode of TV Time with Maggie. If you're new here, hi, my name is Maggie, and I talk all things Latinidad, representation, and women in film and TV. I haven't made a video in a while. It's been a very busy October. There's been a lot of premieres, including Maya and the Three and On My Block. And very recently, we've had the second season of Gentefied, and I was very excited and looking forward to watching it. And so after sitting down and binge watching all the episodes, I have a few things to say. Here we go. When Gentefied first premiered back in February, I believe, of 2020, I found it to be extremely relatable. The characters were well cast. And even though I had some controversy over the representation of Afro-Latinidad and the character of Jessica, I overall really enjoyed it. I love the family drama. I like the gentrification portion of it. And at the very end, we were left with a lot of big changes and decisions made by each and every single character. I very much related to Chris and Lydia. I felt that they were in this kind of position in between being with their family and being part of this culture, but also being assimilated into the American society and what was expected of them in terms of being successful. The series does a really good job of putting these characters, not just Chris and Lydia, but also Anna and Eric, in this kind of inner turmoil between the culture, la familia, and then their own goals and dreams and expectations of what it means to be Mexican American. And this inner turmoil comes to a big bra in the second season when we have our main character, one of our main characters, Pop, going through a possible deportation. And the series shifts a little bit from about this particular community and this family to a larger and bigger issue, not just about gentrification, but the sacrifices that sometimes we have to make when we are undocumented. I like that the second season have these really great dynamic characters in season one being put into extraordinary and stressful situation in season two and really pushing them to the limit. We really see this, for example, in Chris when he's debating between going to Paris, staying home, and being with his family. We also see this with Lydia, who is now in Stanford and dealing with kind of that hierarchy and being in a professional environment, but still wanting to be a mother and a girlfriend and being a good advocate for people of color and being put in certain situations that she's not 100% comfortable with and bringing to light some of her maybe prejudices against certain people in certain circumstances and really shines a light on who she is and who she can be now that she is a mother. We also see this in Anna when she's given this amazing opportunity to draw a particular ad for Nike and she decides to make it political, really tell a story. And I think her artist journey is going to get even more complicated, but in a really good way in season three. I'm hoping for a season three, even though it has not been announced yet. I really like the fact that both Anna and Eric get a little bit more meat this season. I think a lot of it last time was about Chris. And even though with his father being brought into the picture, we do have a lot of more story with him, especially now that he has a love interest. I think in season one, we kind of sort of scratched the surface with Eric and he was the source of a lot of humor in the story. And then in season two, we get a little bit more about him, particularly in the dad department. I think he does a really good job in the episode Daddy and fulfilling this role, but I really want to see more. I think he has a lot more potential, a lot more dreams, and he's kind of not being held back, but I feel like he's self-sabotaging by just focusing on being a good dad and focusing on just being a good cousin. I think once he finds the thing that he's most passionate about and he puts it into fruition, which is his goal of making some sort of thing. I believe it was like a reading program and possibly a book lending program for children to really be exposed to the world through books. I really want to see that in season three. And we were hinted again in season two. We also were hinted of like him and his father's relationship. And we didn't really scratch enough of Eric. And I think we want to see more about him and his journey. Other characters that I really enjoyed watching this season are newcomers into the series. In season two, we were introduced to a couple of really amazing, not only Latina actresses, but Latina characters in the show. Clarissa Tibeyux as Brie, who is the advertising executive who has a relationship with Anna. And I believe that she makes it a point to tell Anna that there is going to be this compromise between the art and telling an authentic story and bridging that gap into more commercial work. And I want to see a little bit more about her and possibly having her being swayed more into Anna's activism side. As the series goes on, we also have Jessica's friend, who's played by Darlene De Morisi, whom I absolutely love. I love her work and she's hilarious. I follow her on Instagram. And they did this really crazy and fun episode called Jessica's Day Off. And I really want to see a lot more of her. I think she brings the character of Jessica to a completely different side that we haven't seen her in the first season. And even at the beginning of the second season, Jessica was always in relation to Anna and in relation to her work as an activist. And I think in this season, we definitely see that there's more to Jessica. We also see Pop's nonprofit lawyer and advocate, played by Melina Bobadilla, and her actual name in the show is also Melinda. And she very much, like Brie, had to balance between like that corporate kind of government law side and her relationship with the Morales and being an advocate while also knowing that there's a limit to what can be done. And I think that she does a really good job in playing that role and guiding the family, particularly Pops, into the media and into the world of immigration and advocacy, and what does that mean to be having your story be put out there and showcased in the way that could be representative of others and possibly be something that could influence lawmakers and policymakers, but ultimately also sacrificing some of your privacy. And for someone like Pops, he has such a tough time with that. I can't even imagine, but I know that a lot of people that are going through something like that usually have to compromise that privacy and that reliving trauma and kind of, borderline making a spectacle out of their life in order to be heard and be seen. Another person that I have mixed and interesting feelings about is Lupe. She is Pop's girlfriend in the season, and they at the very end they do happen to be together, but her and Anna's mother are in this older generation of women who were brought up to believe and to think and to be strong but still be very much a support system for their husbands no matter what. And I think that conversation that they have in the Thanksgiving episode, which is an amazing episode, between like her and Lydia, and really pushing Lydia to very much pick, is she want to be a good mom and a good wife, or does she want to be in the academic world and really pursue her career, and really pushing that balance between you have to be one or the other. And Lydia really basically saying, I can really do both and I can be a dynamic person, and by doing that doesn't mean I have to sacrifice one or the other. At the very end of the series, we end up with Pop and Lupe in their honeymoon in Mexico, and we're kind of left off in this ambiguous scene. I say ambiguous because I really, at the very end, my understanding was that he was able to go and be able to get the citizenship that he was requiring, or the residency that he was requiring, and he was just going there to visit Chris, who got a job over there. But At the same time, I don't know if that meant that he was actually deported. So because we were left in that ambiguous state, and correct me if I'm wrong down in the comments, but because we were left in that bigger state, I really do believe that we need a season three. And I think it would be amazing if season three takes place partly in Mexico and kind of have like the cousin or the family go and visit Chris and have that culture clash between people that were raised here in the United States as Mexican Americans or as Americans with the heritage from another country and going back to that country where we were, you know, told, and even in the show they say things like, why would you want to go back? And we were told that our families came here because their country wasn't doing that well, so why would we like it? Why would we appreciate where we come from? And I think that that's something that we all, first generation and also young immigrants, come in this country thinking, okay, I'm gonna do better here and this is better. But I still miss my home, and there are really great and beautiful things from our native land. It doesn't have to be a tragedy to go back, at least not in the in the way of like deportation, but going back to see family, to see a vacation, it should be something of a joyous occasion instead of a burden. So yeah, that was Gentefied season two. There was a lot that went on. There were other things that I didn't even cover here. I was trying to make the episode as short and concise as possible. But I think that, you know, characters like Sarai and Diane are, you know, also were very fantastic, and we need to see more of them. And having the Morales cousin maybe possibly going to Mexico, or seeing how their lives turns out after the events of season two, are really great starting point for season three. The season has not been announced yet, but I'm really, really hoping that they renew it. Thank you so much for watching another episode of TV Time with Maggie. I am in the process of being a little bit more consistent with my videos, so please stay tuned, not just subscribing to the channel, but also following me on Instagram at PinkLeo_Productions.